Hi, welcome to the Vulnerable Scientist podcast. This is your host, Saranya Kerry. So on this episode, I'm going to continue the first part of Milka's interview, where we talked about her, the introduction to what she is and what she's doing. And now we're going to talk about her lows. And then the next episode, we talk about her highs.
One of the lows I've experienced was job search. When I was doing my master's in Kenyatta University, well, I chose to do a thesis research, and I had a big problem finding a funded opportunity where I could, you know, where I could do the research. And that took about 1 year and some months to find that research opportunity for me to do my thesis research.
And you already done your coursework?
Yes, I finished my coursework very fast. I did my part of my coursework while I was still, like, I started my master's first semester before I graduated my undergrad. I really wanted to do my master's in 2 years. It actually took 4 years. And the main problem was finding that opportunity. Yes, it was 4 years. It was a PhD. So that was my lowest. And I applied. So how I got it, I should say this in case it's helpful to someone. I got this through the Africa Biosciences Challenge Fund called ABCF, which is a fellowship program by BECCA, a research institute in Nairobi hosted by ILRI, the International Livestock Research Institute. They have capacity building opportunities if you look at the ILRI website, and I would encourage people who are looking for a space to learn, grow while doing research to look that up. That's how I eventually got the opportunity. But job search, And not even just job, but just looking for these opportunities to be able to do research. That was one of my lowest.
Tell me about that point. How did you feel about that, you know, when you finally got that opportunity, when you got that offer letter? Tell me about that.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, Sarah, that was a high. Now we are in the highs.
I was so
happy. I can't even explain, because I made the application a year before, and they just updated us. They kept updating us. And now I understand it's because they, on the other hand, were waiting for funding. And they kept encouraging us and letting us know that the applications are being processed. And so when I got the opportunity, I was very happy. And being paid to do research, first of all, there were very few opportunities in the country where you, like, during, like, with our class, where you could do that. So it was a very, very great opportunity. And my excitement at that time, I still didn't know how much better it was. Like, I learned so much through that fellowship over a span of 9 months. I learned so much. It was transformational to me.
Wow. If that issue is a really big problem among master's students and PhD students in Kenya. I can speak for Kenyans. Mm-hmm. The people who are really struggling to get, like, I know people who are saying, yeah, I'm still doing my master's. Okay, so what's the progress? They're like, I'm still looking for, you know, a fun project, especially if you're doing a wet-based project. Mm-hmm. You need money to do research. So the people who stayed in universities just because of that one thing.
Yeah, that is actually one of the main things. And also, like, another thing I'd encourage people is write to people directly. Write emails. If you know a scientist, write to them directly. I know a lot of people, I know people do this, but just to encourage them to keep writing and being persistent in a kind way. One of the other gaps that was there is that we would be told that, oh, you could also write proposals for funding. But then the soft skill for you to know how to write a grant proposal, at that time when I was finishing my undergrad, we didn't have those skills. So those are things that I hope that universities or learning institutes will take up and train us on that, because then we would, maybe it will increase chances of us getting these opportunities. That was one of the lows, just the job search, and it continued after I finished this fellowship that I was so excited about. I didn't have a job. I did get temporary jobs like data collection jobs, and I had amazing mentors. One of them is Dr. Naftali Kitaka and Esther. They sat me down, and I remember thinking, you know, you've studied, you've done your undergrad, you've done your master's, you still maybe don't have a job, and now you think, okay, now I can earn. Right? And then you keep applying for opportunities and you don't find them. And one of the things that they taught me was to just humble myself and go for internship. Apply for internships, and just because I had been applying for jobs for quite a while and PhDs for quite a while. I have a whole folder, Sarah, of applications that are more than 30, I think. And a lot of letters of, are they called regret or rejection?
Rejection.
One of those rejection letters. I got so many of those. But this advice was the most useful. I started looking for an internship, just a chance for me to practice, a chance for me to do research while I apply, while I continue looking. It's hard to do that because you have bills to pay. You have a lot of things going on. So I also understand that it's not going to work the same for everyone. I'll tell you, I was struggling with my bills, but the people who gave me internships, they made sure at least I could pay for the basic needs. But above that, it wasn't enough. But I appreciate that, because that while I was there, I networked. I talked to people. And, you know, God is also great. Like, I prayed. God guided my path through this time, so much. So I don't want that to be missed.
I just wanted to, I wanted to understand you coming from looking for, you're so excited about research, you're undergraduate, you're sure that I'm going to do my master's, because most people are not sure about that. Then you struggle getting a projects which you actually really looked for. It's not like you lazied around. Then you finally get it. It's a very good opportunity. You're working in a nice international institution and getting all these nice experiences that, you know, people at, I can imagine, at that level in Kenya don't easily get. Then now you're here, you are jobless. How was that for you, really? Like, how did you really feel?
I was afraid, Sarah. I was afraid because this has ended and I'm coming from this point. Of course, I had made some savings, but not so much to pay rent for a whole year, right? But I was just afraid. I was afraid of, I would be kicked out of my apartment. How would I take care of myself? That was it. I just remember being very afraid and not knowing what to do. And that's where, like, faith plays a big role. For me, it played a big role, because dealing with such things where there's so much uncertainty in life, faith, that's it. That's what gave me the strength and the courage to keep pushing. And somehow, you know, just people came through. The like I said, the network. This mentor I'm talking about, I just met with him and networked with him, but I asked him, do you have something temporary? I'll go collect data with you. I need to pay my rent, right? In a small apartment. And he did that. He allowed me to do that. I also reached out to other people, but then the humility. So it's humbling and fear and just having faith for me. It changed the game. It's what helped me to keep moving. But it was a scary and humbling moment.
Thanks for sharing that.
The third low point was the COVID one that I mentioned. And this is like a global thing that happens that affects you. And it's like what do you do, right? Who do you, there's nothing, who do you blame? What, it's happening to everyone. And for me, it was another one of those opportunities, feeling like something has been snatched because I worked so hard and I was so excited that I have a PhD and I had started working on it and I had an amazing mentor. But then this thing happens and, you know, you're seeing it on the news and then it turns up on your email. And it's not, you know, the connection. But again, during this time, I felt despair. I was like, you know, I actually gave up on my PhD dream for a while. I did. And then, I just kept praying and said, you know, God, if this is in my path, show me the way, help me to find people or connect with people who will help me. So I got back up, started applying, writing to people, telling them what has happened, and I'm still looking. And these people in turn talked to other people, spread out the word, and they started sharing the opportunities that were available. And that's how I got this PhD.
Wow. How long, wait, before, after master's, how long did it take for you to get a job?
Oh, so after, you know, the internship I did with IITA, when it ended, I got a consultancy position to continue what I was working on, but on a bigger scale. And I'll talk more about this because this is one of my highs in research. Yes. Yeah. So the last low. So I got this opportunity and I was very happy and started it. And I was working with amazing people, you know, in a very good university, with a lot of resources, and which was just the difference. I can see the difference in terms of resources, and I wish this was available back home. But after I started, I was, you know, adjusting to everything, adjusting to the weather, adjusting to the society, to the curriculum here. And then I started having anxiety. You get anxious back. I used to get anxious back home, but it was like one thing. And then here it was like every day because it's really high pace, and at the same time you're adjusting to everything. And I came in during the winter and it was so depressing. Everything, like, it was so hard for me to adjust in that first semester. But I, on the bright side of that is that I had an amazing mentor who kept, you know, telling me it will get better, it will, and it's true that it got better. But one of the lows was just being this, having this anxiety all the time and struggling to adjust very quickly so that I can, you know, keep up in school. So that was another low.
Sorry about that.
Thank you. So this is why I wanted to end with the highs, Sarah.
I love that you shared a lot of lows. I'm thinking, yes, maybe there will be more. Maybe there are more. I don't know. But I love that you shared those. As in, they are very. They show different things about research and growing that career path. Yeah. Yeah.
Yes.
Okay.
Do you want to start your own podcast? Start with some simple gear that you already have and a quiet space. Simple gear includes a microphone, editing software, and host of your podcast. Simple microphones include the ones on your phones and computers, or a simple recorder, which you can upgrade later. For the editing software, I use Audacity, which is free and simple to use. Buzzsprout, which over 1,000 other fellow podcasters like me use, is one of the podcast hosting providers you can use. Buzzsprout has helped me link my show on every major podcast platform with an endless number and regularly updated tutorials and good customer service support Buzzsprout offers. My podcasting journey has been made easy. Following the link in the show notes, let's Buzzsprout know we sent you, gets you a $20 Amazon gift card if you sign up for a paid plan, and helps support our show.